I had forgotten that it's also the first night of the World Series tonight. So let me tell you, our speaker tonight will rival the World Series. I like that. Just some quick housekeeping. The first thing I want to let you know is that Arezu is working on an overview of attendance and surveys that you all have completed. So you can look at that by the end of October and see how that looks based on what you think you've attended or what surveys you've completed. And there'll be a survey tonight as well. Thank you again to everybody who participated in our test last week for Declara. We had about 50 people who posted on, on Critica. We had about 50 people who posted. So thanks for that. And that was kind of a fun discussion for those who partook in that. The other thing is that at the end of November, the large assignment for the series will be due. And at the end of October, you will get the instructions if you can't remember them from our first class. So just a reminder on that. This afternoon, it is my pleasure to introduce a speaker who has distinguished herself in so many different ways. First of all, she is a Cal grad with a degree in EECS. Go Bears. She's also the Chief Design Officer and VP of Design and Engineering at TiVo. And if you don't know what TiVo is, it is like a, from their website, cable box, DVR, Apple TV, and Sling box, all in one. In fact, I read that just recently you can actually use TiVo on your Android phone. She has been with TiVo since 2001, about 2 years after it was founded, and it is unusual to have somebody here who's been with her company for that long, so that's pretty substantial as well. During that time, she's received innumerable accolades. As I wrote in my email to you all today, she has an Emmy for Outstanding Achievement in Interactive Television. It is probably the first, definitely the first, and maybe the only time we'll be able to say that about an engineer who's speaking here, an Emmy Award, but perhaps it's the first of many. You never know. She's also the most powerful woman in cable television for 4 years, in cable, excuse me, for 4 years running now. And she was also the winner of the Silicon Valley Business Journal Woman of Influence Award. It is my pleasure to introduce Margret Schmidt as our Newton Distinguished Innovator Speaker this evening. Margret.
Thank you. Very happy to be here. I think I last stood on the stage. I took Engineering 110 Venture Design class. I don't know that they still offer that, but I had to do my final presentation right here in Sibley. So I'm going to follow the standard kind of recommendation for these lectures. So I'm going to start, I'll talk about my background. I first heard the term or the idea that it's not a career ladder, it's a career jungle gym when I read Lean In, and I will show you my jungle gym. I'll talk about kind of things I've learned along the way. We'll spend some time talking about design and innovation because that's really where I spend my time and the takeaways I'd like you to think about when you're designing and innovating. And then for industry insights, we'll talk about the TV industry since that's my space. And we'll talk about why, while there's a lot of talk about disrupting TV, what's going to make that a little tricky. So we'll talk about the players. So with that, again, kind of my background, EECS in 92. So design and engineering at TiVo, I'm responsible for the user experience side. The what the TV product looks like, so the interaction, the user interface, the TV product, iOS, Android, and our TV Everywhere web portal, as well as the engineering teams that develop that. I've long been on the design side. The engineering responsibility is probably the last 3 years, and we will talk about that. And I have been an engineering manager, a product manager, and a design manager, and in finding my way. And because I am with a TV company, I will show you my favorite TV shows so that you can judge me, because that's what they're good for. So I've just finished, so Downton Abbey and Game of Thrones, I binge-watched all 40 episodes in each season over the last 2 months, like a month of Downton Abbey and then a month of Game of Thrones. And yes, in 2006, crazy wild experience for a nerd girl to win a primetime Emmy, but this is like LA, red carpet, green room, governor's ball. And I have an Emmy with my name on it in my dining room, which is just crazy. So fun journeys along the way. Again, just a little bit about kind of TiVo's history. So in 1999, TiVo launched the first commercial DVR. And this is in the days of VCRs, right? And so very disruptive and revolutionary in the TV space, the idea that, you know, record your favorite shows no matter when they're on, no tapes, no timers. And then the magic of the ability to pause live TV, right? So the phone rings, you can pause it. The kids need you, you can pause it. people would talk about how TiVo changed their lives, right? And where TiVo is today, we talk about TiVo everywhere. So yes, we have DVRs that still record shows, either antenna or cable. We have now streaming capability built into them, so you can watch those shows, whether live or recorded, on your iOS or your Android device. So, you know, I could get out my iPhone and we could watch the World Series from my home, but we won't do that. And really about integrating all of the content sources. So it's not just your cable or your antenna, but you can watch your Netflix, you can watch Amazon, you can watch Hulu Plus, you can watch YouTube, all in the same interface. And so while we have a retail product, we are also increasingly being deployed with cable operators in both the US and internationally, as they are offering technology to their customers to create a great experience. So let's talk about my career path. My journey to Berkeley was a little unusual. I was accepted as a freshman. I did not go. I went to Harvey Mudd. And I went there with 20 other women in the freshman class. It was a small school and a small group of women. And I thought I could get a computer science degree there. And it was still kind of early for them in doing that. And so the answer was kind of, you can get an electrical engineering degree and you can take some computer science courses. And I wasn't really excited about that. Now they have a great program these days, but at that time it kind of wasn't right for me. And Berkeley sent me a survey and said, we accept a lot of women in engineering, but you don't come. Why don't you come? And they had a whole, you know, survey with checkboxes. You know, why did you not choose Berkeley? And the answer for me at the time was a really easy one. It's in Berkeley, and I'm not a city girl. Like, I chose a really suburban campus when I picked Mudd. And then I answered the survey, and I sent it back. And then in thinking about how kind of unhappy I was going to end up being at Mudd, I wrote to the woman who sent the survey and said, well, what if I wanted to come now? And she said, she asked around, and the answer was, well, you were accepted once as a freshman. Apply again as a freshman. Your score should get you in again, which I did. And they did, which was great. And I took a semester off. So I finished my semester at Berkeley, at Mudd. I took a semester off, and then I started at Berkeley the next fall as a freshman. But I had transfer credits from Mudd, from a summer in high school I did at Harvard for my AP classes. And I was able to finish up Berkeley in about 2.5 years after that. So I've been very, very grateful to Berkeley for that opportunity. So I had my great degree, and then I became a real estate broker. It's a really hard decision for me to explain right now. It's a very independent job. The technology, it was kind of a new in the tech space. I was on the peninsula. I was married at the time. I'm still married. Same husband. 24 years in December. It was interesting, right? I could start my own business. Now you start startups when you have this kind of crisis. But I was running my own real estate business, and I was working with a lot of engineers in the Valley. I had an email address, and real estate agents did not have email addresses at the time. And it was great for 5 years. And then real estate there's a lot of psychology in it, right? You're a lot of counseling of buyers and sellers of, you know, no, I think you're making an emotional decision, not a logical one. And it was tricky. And at the time, I was sitting on the operations board for the multiple listing service. So this is the technology that the agents use to list homes and then to see what homes are for sale. So that's how they share that information. And the CEO of that the multiple listing service said, hey, there's this association of realtors, which are these trade associations, and the local associations own the MLS for the five counties that we covered. And they need an executive director. They're trying to hire the head person in this association. Realtors, you'd be great for the job. You should go interview. And so now I have my first real job interview with the entire board of directors at one time for this multiple listing service, which felt to me like a Miss America interview. Like, I believe in world peace. And because when, you know, you're in an interview and you're trying to read your audience, right? And you're trying to speak to what works with, you know, what they want to hear and what they're interested in. And it's really hard when you're interviewing with seven people at once. And they liked me, but they had a hard time imagining giving me the job of running the association while I had great real estate experience. I'd never been a manager. I'd never been an employee. And what they ended up offering me was kind of an IT job. It's a very small association. It had like 11 employees. So I was doing some real estate specific things with contracts and things related to their store. And I was also hooking up their network and making sure their printers ran and the servers worked and kind of all that stuff. And now they're still searching for an executive director. And this is something I learned after two experiences like this. So they hadn't hired my boss. And when they did hire my boss, we weren't really compatible. And one of the things I've only recently learned, this is a great way to explain it, but one of the highest predictors of success in a relationship, whether it is personal or professional, is shared goals and values. And I did not have shared goals and values with the new person they hired. Now, the CEO who had recommended me for this job at the MLS said, hey, my manager of product development left. I have an opening. Come interview. And I interviewed with him. He offered me a job on the spot. He had had experience working with me on this board of operations that I sat on. And he gave me my first management job. And he said, management is sink or swim. Like, you either have it in you to figure out how to take, you know, to take care of people and to make sure they're happy and productive, or you don't. And as your manager, my job is to pull you out if you fail. So he tossed me into that, and I was managing engineering managers or engineers and QA engineers. And we were doing not only running the MLS, so this tandem nonstop system that had all the multiple listing service information in about houses for sale, we were creating the first public website where anyone from the public could go search for houses, and within 15 minutes of something being posted on the MLS, it was available on the website. And so we were making that available to consumers. And so we're doing this in a place where we had no product managers, and we had a visual designer, but no one in kind of the design space. And so as engineering manager, no one in the interaction design space, as engineering manager, I was kind of playing a product manager role and a design manager role. And I thought that, or a designer role, and I thought that was very interesting. And then the board hired a new CEO, and I did not have shared goals and values with the new CEO. So it was time to look elsewhere. And I ended up, so that's the MLS, and I ended up at iPix, originally known as bamboo.com. So now we're in kind of great .com. This is the beginning of the bubble. Well, no, sorry, this is near the end of the bubble, which will explain how I got to TiVo. And they were doing virtual tours of real estate on the web. So they were the ones creating those 360-degree views. When you go to one of these websites to look at a house for sale, and you actually see the 360, that was the product they were creating. And I convinced them to hire me as a product manager. I had not been a product manager, but I said, look, in my last job, there were no product managers. I was kind of playing that role. I have the real estate experience. And they gave me that position. And from there, I actually, at iPix, ended up creating the usability engineering group. So they had product managers, they had engineers, but they had no design organization that sat between the two and took the requirements and created a really great product and iterated it with consumers and then had engineers build it. So what you ended up with was a really fragmented product line where, depending upon who the product manager was and who the engineer was, all the products ended up looking different. And I said, what you need is a centralized organization. We'll take the requirements from product. We'll create a design of a product and write specifications for engineering, and we will look like one product, one company, and we will have useful and usable products. And then the end of the dot-com bubble burst. And we kind of saw it coming. And a bunch of us directors had lunch, and we had this conversation about, like, well, we really like what we're working on and who we're working with, but do we stick around until the end, or do we all go find new jobs now? And we decided to go back to our head of engineering after lunch and said, we kind of need a pep talk. Like, should we stick around or should we all go get new jobs now? And he said, I kind of get how you feel, and HR is coming tomorrow to lay you off. So that was nice. So we've got kind of clarity there. And that night, I went to monster.com. And I had to search for a new job, monster.com. And TiVo had an opening for manager of UI design. And I had had a TiVo for about 6 months at this time, and that was really cool. The only reason I had a TiVo is because my parents were relocating back to a house. My husband helped my mother paint the house. And as a thank you, they sent us a TiVo. So I have this wonderful thing. Now, we were a VCR family. We had like three VCRs going and knew when to switch the tapes and when to, you know, how to, you could only program like four shows at a time or maybe eight on a fancy VCR. So you're constantly kind of reprogramming and switching the tapes. So TiVo is perfect for us. So I interviewed TiVo, thought it was the greatest thing, and kind of, you know, gave them the story of, you know, I've been an engineering manager, I've been a product manager, but design is really my passion. I love your product. I love doing design. And then within 2 weeks, I had that job. And I have been at TiVo for a really long time. I mean, 13 years in the Valley is rare. And for me, it's because I love the product and I love the people. And every time I got that itch that said, I need a challenge because I'm too comfortable doing what I'm doing and that gets boring, I found a way to find that challenge internal to TiVo. And so my responsibility grew. I started with just design, and then the consumer and technical documentation team came into my org. Then the field trials program team, where we run alpha and beta field trials with customers, came into the org. Research was there for a while. And then the last kind of big jump, this big kind of move on the career jungle gym for me, was running software engineering. And that really came from, you know, needing a challenge and wanting something exciting to do and going to my boss and saying, we don't really have someone kind of really running software releases. We do when they're big partner programs, but not so much when it's a retail program. And I would like to step into that role kind of as decision maker for the software releases on our DVR set-top box. And I want to, you know, hear from all the different stakeholders and kind of make a decision to move us forward. And he had to think about it. Because while he saw, you know, my capacity and kind of decision making and those pieces of it, there was this fear that if you put someone responsible for design in charge of shipping product, then I would you'd never ship, right? You'd be like, oh, it's not perfect yet. I need to change some things, and you'd want to hold on to it. But he took that leap. He said, okay, you know, a lot like the CEO who said kind of management is sink or swim, right? I had a boss who said, okay, try it. You know, I'll yank you out of there if you screw this up. And I, you know, I found this place where as long as what we had built was enough better than what they already had, what our customers already had in their homes, that it would be, you know, a crime to not ship this product to them, then you ship it and you move on to the next phase, right? So, because the design will never be perfect. You will always have new ideas. There'll always be some bugs. But as long as what you have is meaningful and good to the customers, you ship it and you move on. So that's a bit about kind of my career path. So things I've learned along the way. So this one's a big one for me in terms of career advancement. Find something in your company that needs to be done and volunteer to do it. So it's not, you know, you're saying, I see there's something that the company would value here and I think I can add value to it. Let me try it. And people see you in a different way. Right? Would my boss have predicted three years ago that I would be running software engineering? No, but I volunteered to run a release. Those went well. I ran more releases. Then when the VP of software engineering left, he said, you're kind of running it anyway, you know, but from the outside by running releases. So, you know, why not? And I got increasing responsibility within engineering as a result of that. I couldn't have predicted this path. He wouldn't have predicted this path, but it came from volunteering. Next point is about attitude. Attitude is one of the things I most look for in an interview. It's one of the things I most value in my employees. This, I see the company needs something, let me figure out how to do that, right? And that's different than an attitude of, that's not really my area, someone else isn't really doing their job. This thing that shows kind of flexibility and passion and interest. And attitudes on the other side, so you can have a very positive attitude, right? I'm willing to do what it takes. On the other side, you can have a very toxic attitude, right? I don't like what I'm doing. I tell other people about it. I tell other people about how the company is screwed up. And that is, I mean, it's very toxic to your group, to you, to your group, to the people that surround you. And it's one of the important things as managers that we have to figure out how to get the toxic people away from the people that are being poisoned. And so really think about kind of your attitude and how you approach things. Be driven by a sense of urgency, right? In your life, in your job, get the important things done quickly. There are always too many things to be done, so you have to prioritize in both your life and your job, but have that sense of urgency. This is really important for me to execute on now. This piece of advice I was given by a great manager. I thought of him as a great manager. He said, great managers make decisions quickly and are quick to change them if they got it wrong. And I've really embraced that and live with that philosophy that so it kind of comes down to, a decision needs to be made. Based on everything I know right now, what's the best decision? And if we get new information later, we can switch. Now, sometimes you don't have enough information right now. And that might be a time to say, we need to get more data here. I struggle with people that always want to, I need more data, I need more information, I can't make the decision now. How about when data could help, it could sway, but you have a reasonable guess about which way it's gonna come out. You say, okay, I'm gonna make the decision now. Let's go ahead in parallel. Let's get that additional data. And if it confirms, great, we were already on this path to move forward. And if it doesn't, then we adjust. And so find that balance. You know, if the data comes back, what could it show you? And what would you do if the worst case came back? How would that change your decision? Be thinking about those things. But make these decisions with a sense of urgency. We need to make some decision here so the team can move forward. Figure out what your company values and figure out how to maximize that. So do they value execution or quality or leadership or innovation? And that might affect what you choose to volunteer for or to show a great attitude or flexibility about. There were some recent comments, a whole thread on Microsoft CEO saying, don't ask for the raise. It's good karma not to let the system work it out. I disagree. I think, so if we go back to shared goals and values, so if I know what my company values and I'm focused on those, and I have shared goals and values with my manager, then you should be able to have an open and honest conversation about what you like to do, what you don't like to do, what you think the company values. Did you get it right? What do they need or want from you? What would make them more successful? And have that conversation. And part of that conversation can be, I'm concerned I'm not, compensated the same way my peers might be or commensurate with my value. I think, again, if you have shared goals and values, if you know what the company values, you can have that conversation. So let's talk about being the only woman in a room. The meeting I actually came from right before this, there were 24 of us in the room. I was the only woman in the room. I had a similar experience. In high school, I took a summer program at Harvard, signed to take an electronics class. Nothing but boys in the room. I really didn't think anything of it. But having a lunch one day in the common area, the head of admissions for the summer program came up and she said, oh, you're Margaret. I'm like, yes. She's like, no girl has ever applied to the electronics class before. We didn't know what to do. So we let you in. Okay. Thank you. Women think differently than men. Diversity of thought leads to better decision-making in the group. So this is really true if you're the only anything in a room. If there's something that makes you different, then know that your voice is very important because your perspective is probably different than the people that might be the same in the room. And it's not always about exactly what you say, but how the team builds off of what you say, right? You offer a different perspective and they say, oh, well, I kind of hadn't thought of that. And maybe it's not that, but it's something like this. And so that is really important in kind of a team dynamic, especially when you're doing innovation and design. So there are kind of two actions here, right? If you're the only woman in the room, speak up. If you are in a room where you see there's the only woman, the only whatever, something that makes someone different, encourage them to speak up, right? You will have a better, you, whatever you're trying to do in that room will be better because you hear from them. So I recently participated in a program on women's leadership, wonderful program. One of the things I learned was one of the reasons that we struggle to, as a society a little bit with women in leadership is this tension between our gender role and our organization role. So our role as women in general is to make people feel better all the time, right? That's how people see women. Oh, they should be making, you know, they make things better. They make people feel good. And that's not the role, that's not always the role in leadership, right? It's not the job of the leader to always make everybody feel better all the time. And so that's why you can feel tension. And in discussing this and how to be a woman in leadership in a way that people feel comfortable with, it was described this role of the queen, which I thought was really interesting. It resonated with me, so I will share it with you. The queen is looking out and making sure that everything is working, right? That people are happy and things are going well and what is getting done needs to get done. And she is kind and she is warm and she is caring. And under her cloak is a sword. And with the sword comes death. And sometimes it's off with your head, right? And in that moment, she is strong and she takes care of business. And then the sword goes back. And then she's warm and caring and the things that people want, right? And from that was just this, you can be these things that people want and like and expect in a gender role, that someone is warm and caring and making them feel better. And then in the moment, you can be very serious and say, this is unacceptable, this needs to change, you know, something has to happen here. And then you can go back to being, you know, warm. And it's something that resonated with me. And in thinking about it more, I really like male leaders that exhibit this kind of behavior, right? Then I say that it is being different from someone who is always saying, this is horrible, you guys are doing terrible, you know, fix this. That's one type of leadership, right, which feels a little bit more like bullying to me, versus, you know, ones that are, you know, focused on when the message needs to be serious, you're very serious. And when the message is more about, we're all doing this together, you know, sense of urgency, sense of purpose, that can be done in a warm way. So just wanted to share my thoughts on that. Let's talk about design and innovation. So as chief design officer for TiVo, I spent a lot of time on the design and innovation pieces. So important distinction, you should always be innovating. I don't actually separate design from innovation. The design process where you're creating anything new, you need to be thinking about innovating. Should we be doing it the same way or should we be doing it different? And do we have a purpose for that? One of the most important factors to success is, are you solving the right problem, right? So you're not starting, oh, I have this cool technology, you know, the solution, maybe looking for a problem to solve. Make sure you have clarity about the problem you're trying to solve. And one of the ways to do that is through observation. So instead of saying, I think this would be a really cool way for people to track their fitness, or this would be a cool health product, instead say, I have a theory that you know, people want a better way to manage their health or take care or track their fitness, and find scenarios in which you can observe people trying to do this or not doing this. And from that, you'll get a broader perspective of what the problem really might be. I was hearing on the radio last night, every 8 minutes, a child is given a missed dose of medication, mostly from parents. Parents aren't accurately giving kids the right medication in certain scenarios. So I might say, oh, I have a great idea for a cool way to measure the medicine and they'll never get it wrong. But I might be completely off base because I don't know why they're actually getting it wrong, right? And so you want to observe those scenarios. How are parents giving kids, you know, medication? What about the tools that they're using today is causing them to get it wrong? Is it the measuring spoon? Is it the can't read the label on the side? And then from that information, then think about what product you would create. Design is fundamentally about empathy and being able to understand how your different kinds of users are going to react and what they need in this product that you're creating. And it's really important to know that design is not about you, and you are never the target user. So if you were today tasked with designing some kind of app that would make this lecture series better, easier, whatever, there's a tendency to want to say, okay, well, I'm a student in this class, and I know exactly what that app should look like, because I want to be able to take my notes this way and share my notes this way and capture photos or videos or whatever that is. But you're here, you're all here for different reasons, different things you hope to get out of it. You all have different learning styles. And to think that because you are one of those users, that every user is like you is a huge mistake that people make. And so again, kind of going back to the observing, to the asking questions, to the interviewing, you know, what do you hope to get out of this class? What tools would make it easier for you? Distilling that down and finding the trends is a really important part of creating your product. You're almost always creating a product with some kind of team. Great teams need diversity and healthy tension. So the diversity, you shouldn't all be the same kind of person, right? You should have those different experiences so that you can build off of each other. And then you shouldn't, you know, automatically gravitate to the same answer. You want some healthy tension. You want those people that can push back and question and say, you know, how are we really, have we really considered the things that need to be considered? Are we doing the right thing here? There are lots of different, you know, design is messy. Design is a creative process. There are lots of different design processes you could go through, but I think it kind of distills down to these core pieces, right? Define the problem you're trying to solve. And you can do that with observation and interviews and kind of that research piece. You then need to come up with ideas on how to solve it. And that's the kind of the, you know, the in the room, the whiteboarding, the creativity piece. That's where you need that team with diversity and with healthy tension. You need to iterate on that solution because you need to go back to users. So you have these people that have this idea, or you have these users that you think you're trying to target. You need to take your idea back to them and see if it's actually resonating with them. You need to build it, and that whole process of building between design and engineering is very collaborative and needs to be collaborative because things will be found along the way. There are easy things and there are hard things, and you want to focus on the easy things that are meaningful to customers, so you want to optimize in your development. And then, you know, this piece that people forget, once it's out there and you release it, you need to get that feedback back from users and let that feed into your next iteration. You might want to create some guiding principles along the way. These are TiVo's first guiding principles before they ship their first product. Really want to get everyone in the mindset that this, while this is a Linux computer attached to a TV, that we don't want anyone to think it's a computer, right? This is an entertainment device. It's about video. And in 2004, the design team said, well, we kind of know those pieces. You know, maybe we want to create a new set of mantras. So think about in the innovation process, are there guiding principles that you want to you want everyone to keep in mind? Look for disconfirming evidence. You think you have a solution. It is really easy to continue to list all the reasons that this solution is going to work and is going to be great. But what is more valuable is to try to poke some holes in it and say, well, who would hate this solution? And is there anything we can do to fix it? Or do we even care because maybe they're not our target users? And so it's much more important in this kind of refining stage that you're trying to poke holes and solve the problems of where it might not work. You need to share your design early and often and without ego. This is one of the things I really work with the designers on because it's so easy to say it's my design and it's perfect and be defensive about it. But instead, you need to listen to what the users are saying, to what your stakeholders are saying. You need to, I like to describe it as we are shepherds of the design. Our job is just to get it to a wonderful place where it has launched. But it doesn't matter where the great ideas come from, right? If they're wonderful, you know, you steal them and you go forth, right? Could it come from a user? Could it come from an executive? Could it come from an intern? Just take it. And then go back to your users. Throughout this process, keep bringing your concepts, your ideas back in front of real people that you think are going to want this product and really listen to their feedback because that is going to tell you. And part of this, you know, design is empathy thing. What you're building is this design gut that in the future, because you've seen so many users use your products, use other products, you can predict how many of your users are going to react to it. And that helps you create a better kind of first iteration, and then you can refine from that. So it's an important thing. Keep watching people use your product. So for the last part, I'm going to talk about the television industry. And it's very, people like talking about disrupting TV, right? So I'm going to give you a little briefing on who are all the players or the actors in the TV space and why disrupting TV is a little bit of a challenge. So first we have to talk about the cable operators. The cable operators are also, in many, many cases, your internet service provider, right? They built that infrastructure that got the cable to the house. Why I say cable operators, it could also be a telco company, anyone who delivers the internet and TV, so less applicable to satellite that does not deliver internet at the same time. They built the infrastructure. They also bundle these services. And so when you get TV and internet at the same time, it's a lower price than buying those separately, right? So you get a bundling discount. You cancel cable TV, and your internet bill will go up. So that's one piece. Second piece is they pay the networks for the channels that they want to carry. And they may pay as little as 25 cents a month to carry, a cable network, maybe, Lifetime, something like that, or up to $5 a month to carry something like ESPN. And so they engage in discussions between the networks and the cable operators on these retransmission agreements. They agree on the price, and they also agree on what rights the cable operator may have to show this content through their VOD service, streaming from their website. All those content rights are negotiated. When those discussions don't go well, then the threat is the cable operator drops the channel. So a little over a year ago, August of 2013, Time Warner Cable and CBS and CBS Sports got into the dispute over the fees. And as a result, Time Warner dropped those channels for a month in LA, New York, Dallas, so in some major metropolitan areas. Now they're heading into football season, right? So Time Warner says, I don't like your prices, I drop the channels. And now you've got customers saying, but I can't watch these CBS shows that I want. What's going to happen when NFL starts? And after a month, they came to some agreements. It sounded like CBS was happier with the agreement than Time Warner was. But that's the reality, right? That cable operators can also drop channels. Now we have the streaming companies. The streaming companies spend billions of dollars on unique content to drive you to their system. You want to watch House of Cards? Then you need Netflix, right? You want the new season they created of Arrested Development? You need Netflix, right? So Amazon, Hulu, they're all spending a lot of money on the original series and the exclusivity. So Amazon Prime has a whole section called Not on Netflix. And on Netflix's side, they will pay more for shows that weren't previously streamable, right? So back to kind of some of those negotiations, for a show that wasn't available to stream from the cable company's website from the beginning of the season, that's actually worth more to Netflix. Because now they can say, it's summertime, watch this, the whole season of the show that your friend said was great. Because your friend might not have told you it was great until half the episodes have aired. And then you're like, well, I don't want to watch a show halfway through, I want to watch it from the beginning. And if while it was airing, there was no way for you to watch it from the beginning, you probably said, well, someday I'll watch that. And then when Netflix comes out and says, great show, we have it from the beginning, that's a reason for you to become a Netflix subscriber. So streaming companies are playing that same dynamic that cable channels do, right? There are shows that you must see, and so that's why you're going to subscribe. Some of the cable operators are subscription-based. So, Amazon Prime is subscription, Netflix is subscription, Hulu Plus is subscription. And then you've got Apple's iTunes, which is more of a pay-per-view model, right? Every episode of a show you want to watch, you need to pay for. And consumers are much more comfortable with the subscription model. If you start to have to think, like, is this show I'm watching right now? Like, really? Should I pay $3 for America's Next Top Model? Maybe not. you know, becomes a different dynamic. It's much easier for people to take, like, it's $8 a month, it's $10 a month, and I can watch whatever I want. And Netflix now has 50 million subscribers worldwide. So let's talk about the studios. So the studios are the ones that sell the content rights, and they sell them to the networks, right? So I have Mad Men, right? And so I'm gonna sell that to AMC. But I also might sell rights to a streaming company. And this is where I have to figure out where the money, where's more money gonna come from? Letting the network have the back streaming rights, or is it more more useful to the streaming company? Is it more valuable to them? Because if they get the streaming rights, then they'll be able to attract subscribers. And the rights do come kind of restricted by platform. You would definitely see sometimes music videos might be licensed to show everywhere except on TV, because there might be, for streaming, you might be able to stream them to other platforms, but not on TV because of the right, the studio kind of divided the rights. Or you might see the streaming rights for premium channels either being tied to, you know, they can't be streamed online unless we know the customer has a cable subscription. So there are lots of dynamics that play there. So the networks, they get paid by the cable operators, right? So they're negotiating that nice big retransmission fee for every subscriber. So they're cable companies that you know have 10 million subscribers and might be paying 10 million times $5 a month to ESPN, right? So every month a check that big. Networks to up their fees, so I get more money if I have stuff people must see. And that's why ESPN with sports, right? People will pay a lot for that. So the networks are focusing on, again, what content can I create that makes my channel something the cable company would not drop, right? There would be an outrage. Because if they dropped AMC and that my loyal followers couldn't get Mad Men, then they're going to switch to satellite, right? So that's part of the dynamic that's playing there. And now just a bit about advertising. Networks want credit for all the ads that are watched, even if they're time shifted. So today there's live viewing, there's live plus what's watched in the first 3 days. If it's recorded on a DVR, the time shifting, there's live plus 7 days. Networks are saying, how about live plus 30? Why don't we get paid for every commercial, even if it's seen 30 days after it's aired? Advertisers want it as close to live as possible, right? Because there are big differences in viewership. So new in the last week or so, right, networks offering direct-to-consumer streaming services. So we've got HBO saying, well, you don't have to subscribe to HBO from your cable company. You'll be able to subscribe to it directly from us online, right? We will. So maybe you just get your programming from Antenna, the major networks, but you can also get HBO. You've got CBS saying, well, you can get CBS. Little different picture there. If I have an antenna, I'm going to get CBS for free anyway. But now when Time Warner says, I'm going to drop CBS, CBS at least has an answer that says, well, you can switch to satellite or you can, you know, maybe they open up for free. If you're a Time Warner customer and they've just dropped CBS, you can get our streaming services for free. So networks are using it to try to maintain leverage. With advertisers, obviously advertisers really need people to watch commercials. And so that's hard when you start talking about streaming services that don't have commercials. You know, advertisers are figuring out how to survive in this world where everyone's going to have a DVR and will fast forward through commercials, or you're streaming it without commercials. And then how do you account for paying for the advertising? You know, do you get to count it only if it was watched live or if it was watched 3 days after live or 7 days? I think it was FX said for Sons of Anarchy, in the prime demographic of 18 to 49 year olds, if you only count what's watched within 3 days of it being aired, they have 3 million viewers. But if you counted within 7 days, then they have 5 million viewers, right? So you see that tension of how much the advertisers want versus the networks want in paying for that content. TiVo content is time shifted about 42% of the time, and the most time-shifted network, meaning you're least likely to watch it live, most likely to record and watch it, is Bravo. Does anyone have a guess about the least time-shifted network? It's a little bit of a brain teaser.
ESPN.
That's the second. The first is the Weather Channel, because I guess there's really no benefit to time-shifting the weather. ESPN is a great guess. And then just on our own, we found in our studies, we find shorter commercials have higher retention. We didn't really poke into why. My theory, though, would be if you're creating a 10-second commercial, your creative is probably more direct and to the point than a 30-second commercial, right? You're probably, you know, more giving the brand message as opposed to telling a story. So consumers, and we're close to the end. Here's what consumers care about. They care about the content. TV is a very emotional experience, right? So I'm investing a long period of time. Watching Game of Thrones, I'm investing 40 hours in that, right? That's different than a movie. So they care about the content, and that's becoming more and more fragmented. They care about cost, and that's why people are trying to disrupt and unbundle. Like, I'm going to cancel cable, and I'm just going to get antenna because that's free. Oh, but I do need, you know, I'm going to have Netflix. I'll have some good stuff, and I need the Amazon Prime, and now I need the HBO. And so they're looking for something where somehow that still saves them money. And then they care about convenience and this idea that how many devices do I have to switch to? It's like, well, I can get this, but only on the computer, but then I want to watch it on the TV. We still see the TV as the favorite screen. People are watching on lots of different screens, but the TV is by far the favorite screen. And especially when the TV becomes a very shared experience, and that's a lot easier to do when it's in a household on the big screen. So they care about the convenience, right? Do I have to figure out who has Downton Abbey and search the different services, or is that kind of all integrated? And so will disruption happen for TV? And so my theory is it will only happen if consumers can get all of the content that they care about in all of the places they want to watch it, so without the weird restrictions on the screens they want it. But the price has to be better than cable's efficient bundle. Remembering that your cable operator is also your internet service provider. And so to the extent you use less of their cable services, what happens to your internet service bill? And what happens to your internet service if everybody's watching TV exclusively over the internet? Think about what caps or throttling they might put in place. You know, is there no longer an unlimited plan on internet to the home? Now, there can be more places than just cable. In some markets, there are more places than just cable to get your internet service. So it might be easier to disrupt in some of those places. But for a lot of America, you know, it's the one cable company that has run copper or fiber to your home. And just the last point on this subject, cable is responding, right? Cable is seeing that others want to disrupt TV, and they're doing things to make themselves more appealing to customers. So they're saying, hey, I have a cable box here. I get that a lot of my customers have Netflix. Let me integrate Netflix into the cable box so that you as a consumer are not switching, you know, to the Roku or your Blu-ray player or your laptop to watch Netflix. And then start questioning, well, I keep switching away from the cable box. Why am I still paying for the cable box, right? So one of the things TiVo does is provide that integrated experience. A cable operator can deploy a cable box with Netflix integrated and meet the consumers for that level of convenience. And it's an integrated search, so it tells you you can record it or you can watch it on Netflix. They're increasingly deploying TV everywhere, so saying we're going to help you get it to all the screens. You as a consumer, as a cable operator, as a cable customer, you want to stream live TV to your iPad, we'll do that. You want to stream recordings, you want things on the PC, covering all of the screens that consumers want. And they are doing more things with their infrastructure to get away from exclusively delivering through the QAM network that they have today and delivering more content over IP. And that increases their capacity, also has the potential to increase their footprint. So now you can imagine a cable company with all of this content, because they constantly negotiate rights, and that's really what, it's all about the content rights, whether the cable operator negotiates it or the streaming company negotiates it. Who has the right to deliver this content to you? And through what mechanism and on what screens? And so, you know, you can imagine a cable operator delivering potentially out of their normal footprint. If all of a sudden we're delivering all TV over IP, maybe I choose to get my TV content from a cable operator in Maine because they had the bundle of content and pricing that I wanted. I'm still paying somebody locally for that internet connection. So finally, if there's just one thing I can share with you about what I've learned and my experiences, is really to be passionate about what you're doing, right? About how, you know, what your role is, what your product is, who are the people you're working with, and if you're creating products, certainly about, you know, about your customers, because a lot of It's so much easier when you like what you do and when you really care about that. And I think it gets you, showing passion gets you a long way. So with that, thank you.
How Margret does everything, including this presentation, because last week she also gave another presentation for an executive class we have. So I just want to really say thank you so much. And I think it's tailored to every single class, so thank you.
Thank you so much for the talk. It was really enlightening. And I especially liked your paradigm on leadership. Both like gender-based, but also in general. I had a specific question on bundling. Like you were saying, there's that tension with the like cable companies. Do you think the attack, so to speak, with like HBO and CBS splitting off, do you think that will accelerate? And if so, do you think like in the next time span, 2-3 years, they might consider like relaxing their bundle and allowing more a la carte channels? Because I was excited for Apple to do that back in the day, but Apple TV never came.
Right, and it's the same kind of problem. I mean, imagine the conversation with a company like Apple or someone else going to a network saying, I want to offer your channel a la carte, right? And they could negotiate a price for that. And now imagine the cable operator talking to that same network and saying, if you offer that channel a la carte, maybe I don't want to pay you for it. Maybe I don't want to offer it, right? So there's that interesting dynamic. So do I think it will change? Certainly, I think things can change. There are more ways to get that content. It takes some of the pressure and the leverage off, right? If there is a better way for me to get the content I want that is cheaper than cable's bundle today, then that will put pressure on cable to adjust their prices, certainly. I think it's this weird dynamic of content rights. Can they really create those? So, you know, CBS is coming out with their service is going to be $6 a month. Cable pays CBS probably about $2 a month for their service. And so, you know, if they'd come out and said it's 50 cents a month, that might have changed to, you know, might have been a bit different. They might not be out. They might not be able to do that based on whatever contracts they have in place. So it will be interesting to see. That's why I see it's kind of it's a when and if thing. Only if we can put together something for the consumer that balances the content, the cost, and the convenience. Now, I guess I would add to that. Now, consumers could change what they're interested in, right? If you start focusing on only watching some shows, you know, it's really bad because you like, you know, Mad Men from AMC and Game of Thrones and Downton Abbey. So you're liking things from a lot of different content providers. If consumers narrow their focus to fewer content providers, if we give up our affinity for sports, like, you know, we don't need to see the World Series, right? If it's more user-generated content or short-form content, I mean, consumers could switch behavior, and that could cause disruption on its own, right? If it's different kind of content you want to watch.
Samara had a question over
here. Hi, thanks for the talk. I had a really quick question about one of the points you made earlier in the talk about making decisions quickly. The context was a little unclear to me about whether it's just for managerial stuff you recommend that, or is it like for everything? Because I'm going through a thought process in my mind, like trying to find every permutation of every decision you would make, and then like which ones would you actually not want to make quickly? Like,
yeah, I mean, I think in general, being able to make decisions quickly is a very powerful skill, right? But you probably want to know how good a decision maker you are. You know, how often is that successful might influence how much time you need to spend on things. And certainly some decisions simply are heavier weight and need more analysis. So my guidance is general. Figure out how to be able to make decisions quickly, because I think that it comes with a sense of urgency, the sense of movement, of moving, whether it's your life forward, your job forward. But you also have to be comfortable changing them if you get new information and it was wrong. And so again, it depends on the decision, and if undoing that is hard, right? I'm going to quit my job is hard to undo. So you might want to spend more time on that, but growing that skill I think is a good one.
Hi. I was wondering, with your technical background, how much of that is used in your current position? Because it seems like you've taken a lot more like design and managerial.
That's a good question. And especially since my background, well, I wrote a lot of code here at Berkeley. I have never been paid for any code I have written, right? So it was a little surprising actually when I, you know, when I was named head of software engineering. Although it was at the time when Scott Thompson had been ousted, I think, from Yahoo for having faked a computer science degree, and I could say, at least I have a real degree. It's important that you understand technical issues, be able to have those conversations with engineering, to be able to say, so why is this hard, and help me understand. We have strong technical leadership, so we have a whole kind of office of the CTO and principal engineers that will make the technology decisions. That isn't part of my job to make those decisions. But to facilitate those decisions and really to put the balance on, and this is where it does come back to the design side, of all the things that we could be doing, what is meaningful to the customer? So on the engineering side, one of my big tasks was looking at just the bugs that were coming in on products. And as an engineer, when a bug comes to you, you feel a moral obligation to fix it, right? It's clearly a defect in the code and I should change it. But not all bugs are meaningful to customers and not all need to be fixed. And it's more important that we fix the ones that are. And so it's important, I think, that I understand the technology in the background, but it isn't part of my core things that I bring to the organization.
I'll stay after.
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. I was wondering from your past managerial experience, what are some menus where you see more hierarchical teams succeed, where managers, sub-managers, etc. are assigned? Versus where are some venues where you see more flat structure succeed, where leaders rise naturally?
That's a good question. I think it's a balance of both. One of the things I learned, in this kind of women's leadership thing I took, was that every group has a hierarchy, even if there isn't one declared. But the hierarchy is actually determined by the group based on whether they see you adding value to the group, right? So there's kind of an unspoken hierarchy. And so that's where the natural leader, you can be in a room of people designing a product where it might be really, you might have directors in there, you might have interns in there, some in design, some in product, some in engineering. You know, there might theoretically be an organizational hierarchy, but when you're trying to solve a problem, sometimes it's not clear whose decision is it, right? But those that rise to the top that are seen as making the decision that's in the best interest of the group, which is usually, you know, it's the group and it's the company, can grow. I think on the tops-down hierarchy, that only works if your hierarchy is really in tune with the product and the consumers and the people that are building the product, which is the engineering organization. I feel that my responsibility on the engineering side is happy and productive engineers working on the most important features for the product, for the company. And so a lot of my leadership and decision-making is around that. I'm not sure I have a really good answer to this. It has to be connected, right? The leaders have to be connected to the product, to the customers, and to the team that's building it. Otherwise, it's not going to work, right? It's like they're making decisions in a vacuum, completely unaware. I don't know if I got a really good answer to that. I tried.
Okay. I am curious. One of the things that you said is, as an engineer, it's hard to keep your ego out of what you're doing. And I am wondering, as we're all trying to get feedback in whatever we're doing, regardless of whether we're designing a product or building a program or building something else, what are some things that you would recommend that we ask ourselves in order to keep ego out?
That's a good question. I think you want to be aware, when you hear the feedback, I think you need to be, you're going to have a gut reaction to that, right? We can't help, but you know, sometimes you hear someone saying, that's a terrible design, or you did it wrong, and that's going to hurt. And you need to have the awareness of that and not react right away, and to ask yourself, can I see their perspective? Do I agree with what they're saying? Is there some truth in there? And maybe it's not the entire truth, but really hearing it. So I think that's what, like, when you push back, are you pushing back because you were hurt, or do you have, you know, or do you really think it's a terrible idea? Because there are terrible ideas. People will comment on your design and say, that's crap. And their suggestion is terrible. And you have to figure out how to navigate and educate. And it's what we find on the design side, is a lot of time spent educating about who our customers are, how they're going to use it. Because some of the feedback can, just like you might design for yourself, you're gonna, when you look at a design, you're gonna give feedback based on your own perspective. And so then we spend that time trying to educate. It's like, well, but think about our users that are like this, and here's why they wouldn't see it that way. And so it's kind of that balance. I think it's just being aware that that's a reaction you might have to want to be defensive.
Yes.
Just a follow-up question to that, kind of. So in the event that you are kind of hurt by someone else succeeding and, like, you know, doing something that you thought you could do and your idea failed, but the other person succeeded, whether it's in your own company or in a competitor's company or just out there in the world, how do you personally regain your self-confidence and gain that momentum again to continue and try again? Like, you know, fail and then get up again.
Right. That's a good question. So a lot of it comes down to the kind of the attitude and the flexibility. And what did I learn from this? Okay, so, you know, if it's in the company... Let's say it's a competitor, right? That's someone else has done something great. You want to think about why wasn't ours that great? What could we have done differently? What can we learn from this? Is there a way that we can do something even better than what they're doing, and kind of rethink? And so, and when it's internal, I think maybe focusing back on, so what is my company value? Some companies value fail fast, right? That means you tried. So then you can write it off to that. It's like, I tried, I gave it my best, but my company values that. So I'm gonna try again, and I'm not gonna be afraid to try. If your company values execution, and maybe you had a failed execution in some way, the software release was late, it had too many bugs, it wasn't what the customers wanted, whatever it was, then you want to focus on what would have made our execution better. Is there a decision we made quickly that maybe we shouldn't have made? So try to turn it into a learning experience. It is hard. There are going to be things that hurt, right? That you feel like crap. But if you have those things you are passionate about, you can focus on those, right? And so, you know, you give yourself some time to feel like crap and then find the thing that you are excited to work on. Maybe have that relationship with your manager. Sometimes you really need to talk to somebody about, like, what just happened. And if you found a manager that you have shared goals and values with, they'll help you get through it too, right? Because they'll point out the things that you did really well that you're probably not even acknowledging to yourself, right? It's so easy to focus on the thing that failed. It's like, but all these things were good. Something horrible happened. It turns out you picked the wrong reaction to it, right? And then the end result was failure, but you did a lot of great things here, and now we just need to focus on fixing this. So a good manager can be really powerful in kind of getting through that.
I want to thank you for sharing your passion with us. And also, I think Margaret's going to stay for a few minutes if you all have questions. And does anybody know if there's been a score yet in the game?
3-0 Giants.
Yes. Wow. Thank you very much for everything.